हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू? ओके, वेरी गुड। तो डियर स्टूडेंट, वी विल स्टार्ट आवर टुडेज लेक्चर। येस्टरडे वी स्टार्टेड आवर सब्जेक्ट ओएसए, ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम एंड एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन। येस्टरडे आई हैव गिवन यू द इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट आवर सब्जेक्ट। We discuss the syllabus structure, okay, for this OSA. We discuss the content of the syllabus. We discuss the course objective and the outcomes. As well, we discuss the reference books and the textbooks which are required for this subject, okay. And I started the unit number one, okay. Yesterday, we started the unit number one. So again, I ask that is there any difficulty in syllabus contents or course objective, course outcome? Okay, shall we proceed towards our first unit? Yes. So I will share with the slide. I will share the slides with you. Okay. I hope that the slides are visible to you. Is it visible to you?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So this is our unit number one, introduction to the operating system. Yesterday I made it clear that what we are going to learn in this subject throughout the entire semester, we are going to learn many things about operating systems. Now one thing you make it clear that the operating system and administration, this subject we are going to learn with respect to Unix operating systems. Okay, my dear students, you kindly make a note that here we are going to learn all the concepts with respect to Unix operating systems. Okay, and Unix and Linux. So later on, as the number of flavors of Linux comes in market, so the popularity of the Linux operating system increases. And nowadays, the Linux operating systems is famous. So we are having a flavor, or we are having a content with respect to the Unix and Linux. So there is no any other operating systems we are going to learn here, like Windows or Mac OS or other operating systems. In unit number six, later on, we are comparing the Linux and Unix with advanced operating systems. Okay, that surely we will discuss, but the major focus is on Unix operating system. All the concepts we are going to learn with respect to the Unix operating systems. So these are the content of our unit number one. That yesterday also we discussed the general overview, history of the Unix, system structure, user's perspective, operating system services and assumption about hardware, basic concepts of operating systems, kernel, shell and file system structure, basic concepts of Linux, basic commands of Linux, advanced Linux commands and installation of Linux and interactive installation. So these are the contents of or you can say these are the articles of our unit number one. Okay, so general overview. So what is the general overview? General overview will give you the idea about the Unix, that how Unix become popular, what are the features and the characteristics of the Unix that make Unix operating system popular. This we discussed yesterday, but again I revise. So here, what are that main features that makes the Unix popular? As I said yesterday, that Unix is written in high level language. Okay, the system is written in the high level programming language like C language. Okay, so that's why it is easy to read, understand, change and move to the other machines. Okay, So the Unix operating system is written in C high level language. Okay. So we know that C is very familiar and C is very easy to understand, easy to read, easy to make changes, and easy to execute on other machines also. So that's why the C language is used to design the Unix operating system. And this is the one of the reason that's why the Unix become so popular. Then second reason is that it has simple user interface that has power to provide the services to the user, whatever the user wants. So simple user interface, that means the GUI, that is the graphical user interface, or the interface, we normally call it as the interface, that is very simple. Anybody can connect to that operating system easily, and that's why it has become popular. So also it provides the various primitives. Yesterday I discussed about the primitives. Primitives are nothing but the library functions. Primitives are nothing but the inbuilt functions, readymade functions. These functions are available in this Unix operating system that permits to write the complex program that to be built from simpler programs. So you can write a complex program with the help of these primitives. Okay. So that's why the Unix becomes so popular. Then another reason is that it is having a hierarchical file system, like a tree structure is there. Okay. So that file system is easy to maintain and easy to implement. Okay. Efficient to implement. So that is one of the reason the Unix become popular. Another reason is that it uses the consistent format for files. So file formats plays the important role. Okay. Every file, we know that file is one of the biggest resource of any operating system, because whatever we are writing the programs, but that programs later on converted into files. Whatever we are performing or whatever operations with respect to operating systems, the operating system treats that operation as a one resource, and that resource is nothing but the file resource. Later on, there are different resources that we will discuss. Okay, but this file system is consistent with respect to the formats. The format that is the byte stream format, which makes the application program easier to write. Okay, so that is one of the reason. That's why the Unix becomes so popular. It provides the simple, consistent interface to peripheral devices. Then it is multi-user, multi-process system. Each user can execute several processes simultaneously. And last one is it hides the machine architecture from user, making it easier to write the programs that runs on different hardware implementation. So dear students, these are the some of the reasons which are given, and these are the reasons that makes the Unix become popular. Okay, so yesterday I said that majority of the IT industry all over the world are using the platform as a Unix system, Unix operating systems. Okay, because Windows, we can say that Windows is used for home use, okay, or for personal use, or for entertainment purpose. Okay, but obviously the Windows is also used in industry. But if you see the proportion, or if you see the ratio, you can find out that majority of the industry are using the Unix platform for their research and development, and for their science and technical applications, technological applications. So that is the reason why Unix become popular. Okay, so you keep in mind, you remember all these points that makes the Unix popular. Okay, now next point is the history of the Unix operating systems. Okay, now dear students, history means when the Unix operating system is invented, how it is invented, and what are the who were responsible for developing this Unix operating system, that we are going to discuss under this history. Okay, here one by one we will see quickly. The list is very big because it starts from 1969. You can see on your screen, it starts from 1969, the beginning. The history of the Unix starts back in 1969 when the scientist Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie and others started working on a little used PDP-7 in the corner at Bell Labs, and what was to be become Unix. So PDP is nothing but, what is this PDP-7? PDP-7 is the mini computer that is designed by Digital Equipment Corporation. Okay, so that is the name of the industry, Digital Equipment Corporation. They develop the mini computers. Okay, and this scientist Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, you kindly make a note of these two scientists because they are responsible for design and development of this Unix operating system. Anybody, this can be a general question or a general knowledge question, that who is responsible for designing and development of Unix operating systems. So dear students, kindly make note that Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie are the two scientists. They are responsible for design and development invention of Unix operating system in 1969 in Bell Labs. Okay, is it clear to everybody? Is it clear to everybody that this can be asked? Generally, anybody can ask you that who invented the Unix operating systems. Okay, so 1969, the scientist name, the Ken Thompson, Dennis Ritchie, they invented this Unix operating systems. Now you can see there are lots of changes. After 1969, in 1979, the first edition of the Unix operating system comes in market, and what it is, it had an assembler for PDP 11 by 20 file system. It is having a fork, then a ROV and the ED. It was used for text processing of the patent document. Now you can ask the question that what do you mean by this fork? What is this ROF, ROFF, and what is this ED? Isn't it? Means see, PDP is what? PDP, that is PDP is the mini computer, which was designed by Digital Equipment Corporation. Means a mini computer means in the industry, those days in 1971 or 1970, the mini computers were used. Okay, the size of one machine is as good as the size of one laboratory. Okay, the size is very big, and the machine that is the PDP is designed by Digital Equipment Corporation. So in 1971, the assembler for this mini computer is added in this edition. Assembler, you know what is mean by assembler? Assembler is a system software that convert the assembly level program into machine level programs. Okay, so that is a role of assembler. So that assembler is added in this mini computer along with the file system. Okay, along with the file system, along with this fork. Now what is the fork? F-O-R-K. Fork is a system call. Okay, as well ROF, double F. This is a text formatting computer program. This is a program, small program, ROFF, text formatting computer program. Then also this ED is the editor. Okay, so these features are added in this Unix operating systems in 1971. Okay, then in 1973, you can see the fourth edition comes in market, which was rewritten in C language, and this made it portable and changed the history of operating system. 1973, you can read there. See what is written there. It has rewritten in C language, and this made it portable and changed the history of operating system. The C language means the use of the high level language for writing the system calls, for writing the programs, for writing the designing the Unix operating systems. That took place in 1973, and it changed the history of operating system. Then you can see in 1975, the sixth edition, Unix leaves the home, also widely known as version 6. This is the first to be widely available outside the Bell Labs. The first BSD version was derived from V6. Now what is the BSD? Okay, BSD is the company Sun Microsystem licensed Unix and implemented a version 4.2 BSD, which they called as Sun OS. Okay, Sun operating system developed this 4.2 BSD version, and this BSD version is called as Sun operating system, Sun microsystems or Sun operating systems. Okay, That happens in 1975. You can see the Unix is become popular in 1975. It come out from Bell Laboratory, and Sun Microsystem derived the BSD version, which is popularly known as Sun operating system, Sun OS. Then you can see the in 1979, the seventh version or the seventh edition, it was the improvement over all the preceding and following the Unix. That is, it had a C, UC, UUCP, and the bond shell. It was ported to the VAX, and the kernel was more than 40 kilobytes. Now, see this. UUCP means what? This is a Unix to Unix copy. Okay? Unix to Unix copy. So, in 1979, the improvement over all the preceding and following Unix, it had C, as well as Unix to Unix copy, UUCP is nothing but the Unix to Unix copy, and the bond shell. Now this shell is introduced in 1979. The bond shell is introduced in the Unix operating system. Now we will see what do you mean by shell, shell script, shell program, types of shell. All these things are there in your syllabus. Okay. Right now you don't bother about this word shell. Bond shell. Okay, I will explain in detail what is meant by shell, what are the functions of shells, and what are the types of shell. Okay, so that all things are there in your syllabus. But in 1979, this improvement is made in the earlier version of the Unix, that a C and the Unix to Unix copy and the bond shell are introduced to become means the kernel was more than 40 kilobytes. Okay. Next, you can see in 1980, the Xenix, the Microsoft introduced the Xenix, that is 32V and 4BSD introduced. In 1982, System 3 AT&T's Unix System Group released the System 3, the first public release outside the Bell Laboratories. Okay, like in 1983, the System 5 Computer Research Group, Unix System Group, and the third group merged to the Unix System Development Lab. In 1984, 1986, lots of changes took place in the Unix, and these changes continues till 1991. Okay, see here, till 1991 the changes took place, means after 1991 also up to in the, we are in 2021, the changes took changes are taking place, and the refinement means the many more things are added, and the Unix system is modified so that it becomes widely used. These changes are still going on. But what happened in 1991, you see, the Unix system laboratories becomes a company majority owned by AT&T, and the Linus Torvald, okay, Linus Torvald is the name of scientist. You kindly make note of this. In 1991, the Linus Torvald. Okay, the name of the scientist who developed the Linux operating system. Okay, this is the major change, drastic change took place in 1991 in Unix operating system, and later on the Linux becomes so popular. So this Linus Torvald is the name of the scientist. What he did, he implemented a project. And you will be surprised to know this project was his last year engineering project. Okay, like we are having a project for last year students, B computer students are implementing their projects. Okay, like this Linus Torvald implemented a final year project, and that project is a operating system which become familiar and which become famous with the name of Linux. Linux operating systems. So he added a number of features. Normally the GUI and a graphical user interface and all this interactive features are added in that operating systems, and it becomes widely used, very famous all over the world with the name Linux operating systems. So is it clear to you that who is the developer of Linux operating systems? The name of the scientist is Linus Torvald. You kindly make a note of this. Linus Torvald is the name of the scientist who was responsible for design and development of the Linux operating systems. Okay. And Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie are the two scientists. They were responsible for design and development of Unix operating system in 1979. Okay. This is the history. Means many more things are there to discuss, but what we will do, we will summarize all these things in this slide. See, you can see, you can read on your screen that the Unix operating system founds its beginning in Multics, which stands for Multiplex Operating Systems and Computer Systems. The Multics project began in mid-1960 as a joint effort by General Electric, then MIT, and Bell Laboratories. In 1969, Bell Laboratories pulled out the project. See, the first paragraph is what? That in 1960, these three companies, General Electric, then MIT, and the Bell Laboratories, they come together and they were working on a project called Multics. Multics stand for Multiplexed Operating and Computing Systems. But what happened in 1969, this Bell Laboratory pull out of the project, means they come out from this project. Three companies were there, and in 1969, this Bell Lab come out from that project. Then one of the, in second paragraph you can read, one of the Bell Laboratory people involved in the project was Ken Thompson, and he liked the potential Multics had, but felt it was too complex and that the same thing could be done in simpler way. Ken Thompson, who was working in Bell Laboratory, he was he was very interested in that Multics, and he felt that it was too complex and the same thing could be done in simpler way. Okay. So in 1969, he wrote the first version of Unix called Unix. The Unix stood for Uniplexed Operating and Computing System. Although the operating system had changed, the name stuck and was eventually shortened as Unix. Okay. So this is a very interesting point that you come to know. In 1969, one of the scientists from Bell Lab, Ken Thompson, who was interested in Multics, and he added something in that Multics operating. He wrote a first version of Unix. Okay. And in third paragraph, what happened? Ken Thompson team up with the Dennis Ritchie, who wrote the first C compiler. See here, Dennis Ritchie, we know that who was also responsible for design and development of the C language, okay, C compiler. So what happened in Ken Thompson, along with Dennis Ritchie, who wrote the first C compiler, in 1973, they rewrote the Unix kernel in C language. This was a very big change. The drastic change took place in 1973, that the Dennis Ritchie along with Ken Thompson, they rewrite the Unix kernel in C language. Following in a year, a version of Unix known as fifth edition was first licensed to the universities. Seventh edition released in 1978 served as a dividing point for two divergent lines of Unix development. These two branches are known as SVR4, that is System 5 and BSD. So that happens in 1978. Okay, so here you can come to know the what is the history of Unix operating system. Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie in 1973 rewrite the Unix kernel in C language. Okay, and in 1978 the seventh edition was released, and the two branches like System 5 and BSD that took place or come out in 1978. Now again you can see the Ken Thompson and this Dennis Ritchie. Okay, Ken Thompson spends a year sabbatical with University of California at Berkeley, where there he had two graduate students, Bill Joy and Chunk Haley, wrote the first Berkeley version of Unix, which was distributed to the student. This result in the source code being worked on and developed by many different people. The Berkeley version of Unix is also known as BSD, Berkeley Software Distribution. From BSD came the VI editor, C shell, virtual memory, send mail, and support for TCP/IP protocol. So see how then the next version, Berkeley version of Unix comes in picture. Okay. And that Berkeley version of Unix, also known as BSD, okay, Berkeley Software Distribution, from that BSD came the VI editor, C shell, virtual memory, send mail, and support for TCP/IP protocol that comes in this invention. Then for several years, the system SVR4 was more conservative, commercial, and well supported. Today, SVR4 and the BSD look very much alike. Probably the biggest cosmetic difference between them is the way PS command functions. So we will see all these commands later on, what is the difference between this PS command for system 4 and BSD. Then you can see the Linux operating system was developed as a Unix look like and has a user command interface that resembles SVR4 that took place in 1991 by the scientist Linus Torvald. Okay, so this is the summary of the history of Unix. Okay, so these things are very important because anybody can ask you that who was responsible for design and development of the Unix operating system. So also these things are in your syllabus, so you must know some history or something about the Unix development and design. Okay, so I hope that it is clear to everybody. If you are having any problem, you can free to ask in between, or you can also write the message in your text box so that I can answer. Okay, anybody is having any questions or a query or having any different opinion, so that we can discuss on that history of Unix operating systems. So who is responsible for designing of Unix? Can anyone answer? Who is responsible for designing of the Unix or invention of the Unix? You can write your answer in chat box. Name the scientist who invented the Unix operating systems. Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, that is the correct answer. Means not only Ken Thompson along with Dennis Ritchie in 1969, these two scientists were responsible for invention of Unix operating system. My next question is, who is responsible for Linux operating systems? Who is responsible for Linux operating system? Linus Torvald, very good. In 1991, Linus Torvald, who was a student of final year engineering, and who developed his project, final year project, as an operating system feature, and that became very popular as a Linux operating system in 1991. Yes. So this few things are very important as far as the history of the Unix operating system is concerned. So two very important points we discuss in general overview. That is, first one is what makes the Unix popular? What makes the Unix popular? And second one is what is the history of the Unix operating system? So see here, what makes the Unix popular? This is the first point. And then the history of the Unix operating system that we discuss in the general overview of the Unix operating system. Now the next article is the architecture of the Unix system. This is very interesting and very important as far as the understanding of the Unix operating system is concerned. Okay, so architecture of the Unix system, you kindly observe this figure. This figure is very important and you have to remember. Means I can say that you have to make a note that this figure is very important, and in examination 100% this will be the question, explain the architecture of Unix operating systems. Okay, so this is the architecture of the Unix system. You can also, sometimes in a question paper, it is asked that explain the overview of the Unix operating system. Whenever there is a question overview, so this is also architecture of the Unix operating systems. So whatever may be the questions, overview or the architecture, you have to draw this figure. Okay, you need to draw this architecture in the examination, architecture of the Unix operating systems. So you can see this is the high level architecture of the Unix system. This is called as, this is a high level architecture of Unix operating system. So clearly you observed there are layers. Okay, so I can point out there. So this is the first layer, that is the hardware layer. Then second layer is the kernel layer. The third layer are the number of programs. Later on there is the application programs. Okay, so this is a layer architecture. Yes, sometimes the question can be asked like explain the layer architecture of Unix operating system. So same figure you have to draw there. So now you see how many names are there. It can be called as the architecture of the Unix system. It can be called as the overview of the Unix system. It can be called as the layer architecture of the Unix system. Okay, whatever it may be, but you have to draw these all questions. So this is the high level architecture of the Unix system. As you can observe there, the hardware is at center. Hardware is at center. You can see the hardware is there at center. Yes or no? The hardware is there at center. And what the hardware is doing, hardware provides the operating system with basic services. Okay, all basic services are given by this hardware to the operating system. And what are these basic services? Right now you don't bother about these basic services. Our next article we will discuss what are the services provided by operating system. But right now you keep in your mind that the hardware is at center and it provides the basic services to the operating system. Okay, now operating system interacts directly with the hardware. Operating system interact directly with the hardware, providing a common services to the program and insulating them from hardware. Okay, so see here, operating system directly connected with hardware. Now you can ask the question, sir, where is the operating system in this figure? Where is the operating system in this figure? Okay, my dear student, okay, you again listen it clearly. Here the second layer, the kernel is shown, kernel. Okay, this kernel is nothing but the operating system. Okay, kernel is the heart of the operating system. Kernel is a very, very important part of any operating system. Kindly make a note. And what is its function? I will explain later on. There, that is there in your syllabus. Right now you don't bother, don't worry about the meaning of kernel, don't worry about the services of operating system. You just try to understand the architecture of the Unix. I will make all the things clear to you. Okay, so you can see there the hardware is at center and hardware is directly connected to the kernel. So what it means? It means that kernel is nothing but the operating system which directly interact with the hardware. Directly interact with hardware. Okay, are you getting what I'm saying? Students, give the reply. Are you getting what I'm saying? Kernel is nothing but the operating system which is directly connected to the hardware. Okay, abhi ye hardware kya hai? Okay, so this hardware is nothing but the hardware which is available on the motherboard. So aapke paas laptop hai, everybody is having a laptop, computer system. So computer system is having a motherboard. Motherboard, all hardware is available on that motherboard. So that motherboard is nothing but the hardware here. Okay. आपका जो सिस्टम का मदरबोर्ड या हार्डवेयर है दैट इज शोन हियर एज अ सेंट्रल पार्ट और द मिडल पार्ट. देन कम्स व्हाट? देन कम्स द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम. तो उसी को यहाँ पे नाम दिया है कर्नल. तो आपको एक चीज यहाँ पे याद रखनी है कि कर्नल इज नथिंग बट द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम. कर्नल इज द हार्ट ऑफ एनी ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम. तो अभी ये सब्जेक्ट आप जो पढ़ रहे हैं ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम एंड एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, ये पढ़ते समय हम बहुत बार ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम को कर्नल के नाम से कॉल करेंगे. वी विल कॉल ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम एज अ कर्नल. ओके, कर्नल इज अ हार्ट ऑफ एनी ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम और उसके जो फंक्शंस है वो फंक्शंस मैं आपको यहाँ पे नेक्स्ट आर्टिकल में आपको ये ध्यान में रखना है कि कर्नल इज अ ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम दैट इज डायरेक्टली कनेक्टेड टू द हार्डवेयर. ओके, दैट इज डायरेक्टली कनेक्टेड विथ हार्डवेयर. एंड नाउ यू कैन सी दिस कर्नल इज इंसुलेटिंग सम प्रोग्राम्स फ्रॉम हार्डवेयर. इंसुलेटिंग का मतलब क्या है? व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय इंसुलेटिंग? कर्नल इज कीप अवे some of the programs from hardware. What are these programs? Now you can see the third layer of this architecture where some of the program name is given, like sh is the shell, who is the command, a dot out is the program, date, wc word count, grep, ed is the editor, vi is the vi editor, ID, AS, COMP, CPP, and ROF. All these are the programs which the kernel is insulating them from hardware. Okay, that comes at third level of the architecture of the Unix system. Okay, what comes at third level of the operating systems? The third layer contains the number of programs which the kernel insulate them from hardware. Okay. ये अभी आपको ये अंडरस्टैंड करने के लिए आपको आपका लैपटॉप का एग्जांपल लेना पड़ेगा. हार्डवेयर रहता है आपके मशीन में, हार्डवेयर है. लैपटॉप इज हैविंग अ मदरबोर्ड, दैट इज हार्डवेयर. एंड देन वी आर इंस्टॉलिंग द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम. आपने विंडोज या फिर उबंटू आप इंस्टॉल किया होगा तो हार्डवेयर के ऊपर क्या आएगा? ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम आएगी, दैट इज नथिंग बट द कर्नल. आपके पास एक बार ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम आ गई तो उसके ऊपर आप क्या करेंगे? प्रोग्राम रन करेंगे. So that is nothing but this third layer program. And then come the last layer, that is the other application program where the user is directly connected. User is directly connected. Ki jo aap end user kehte, end user. I am an end user. You are an end user of your machine. So that end user comes at last layer of this architecture. Okay. Hope you can understand it. With the help of your laptop example, the hardware comes at middle. Then we install the operating system, that is nothing but the kernel. Then we install the various softwares, that is nothing but the program. And then the application programs which are connected with the help of user, that is the end user, which comes at last layer of the Unix architecture. Okay. So is it clear to everybody? The architecture of the Unix operating system, or you are having a doubt, you can you are free to ask the questions, because this is very important. This is very important. Everybody should clear with this architecture of the 100%. There will be a question in examination. Explain the architecture of the Unix system. Explain the architecture of the Unix system. If you are having any doubt, you can ask. Okay. Kernel is what? Kernel is the operating system. Right now you keep in your mind, kernel is the operating system. And all these programs are nothing but the programs. Shell is the program. WHO, who is the Unix command? Date is the Unix command. WC, word count is the Unix command. ED is the editor. Grep is the command. VI is the editor. CPP is the compiler. NROF is the text processing program. All these are the programs which are run on the Unix operating system that is shown in the third layer of this architecture. And the last layer of this architecture is the application program. That means the end user who is writing the program at the top layer or the lower level programs. Hence, it exists at the outermost layer of the Unix program. For example, now the CC compiler, which is executed at the outermost layer, as it is shown here, the CC stands for the C compiler. It comes at the outermost layer of this architecture. Okay. Yes or no? Like compiler, assembler, loader, all these things that comes at the outermost layer of this Unix architecture. Okay. So this is very interesting and the very important part of your syllabus, Unix architecture. Okay. If you are having any doubt, what is this A dot out? Okay. See here. A dot out is the standard name for executable files produced by C compiler. A dot out. आप जब C program को compile करते हैं, तो A dot out file create होती है. A dot out is what is the standard name for executable file produced by C compiler. ये आपको मालूम है. WHO who is the Unix command that will tell you who is currently log on to the system. Who? SH is the shell is nothing but a program. Shell is nothing but the program. Okay, types of shells are there. That is a very different concept that is there in your system, in your syllabus. Okay, now kernel is what? Kernel, I will focus on the kernel shortly and briefly. Okay, kernel is the operating system which is designed with number of system calls. Kernel is designed with, what is the system call? New thing, new terms comes in your syllabus. System call. So what is the system call? System call is like an ordinary C function. There are number of system calls in Unix operating system. It likes the ordinary C function which returns something. कि आप जो C language में functions लिखते हैं, functions आपको मालूम है कि every function is having a name. Every function is having a body of statement and every function returns some value. So that is a C language function. And system call kya rehta hai? System call is also like a function which is having a name and which is having a body of statement and which returns something. That is nothing but a system call. Now you can surprise, there are about 64 system called in Unix operating systems. 64. Now maybe more than 64, but in our syllabus, the textbook, it is mentioned 64 system calls are there and more than 32 system calls are used frequently. And these system calls are used to write a operating system or to design operating systems. What is the system call? System call is like an ordinary C function. There are 64 system calls in a Unix operating system. More than 32 system calls are widely used, frequently used in Unix systems. Okay. And Unix system or the kernel is written or designed with the help of this system call only. Samajh mein aa raha hai aapko? Are you getting what I am saying? Student, please reply. If you are having any problem or question in your mind, you can free to ask. You are free to ask right now. Okay. Later on also you can send me the, you can call me at any time or you can message me for your doubts and questions. Or also today in your chat box, you can write your questions. What is mean by kernel? And number of commands are there that we will going to discuss. Linux commands are there. Okay. And today we are having one practical. Today there is a practical of OS lab in afternoon. There I will tell you some of the Linux command. Okay. Number of things are there. This subject is very interesting. Very interesting means you will take you will be very happy to learn and understand the Linux commands and shell programs and this all things of Linux operating systems. Any doubt up to this? Any doubt, any questions up to this? So that if no doubt, then we can proceed. Or if you want to ask anything, then you can ask. Yes. What is CC? Very good question. Okay. CC is the standard C compiler. Okay. CC. And which comes at outermost layer of this architecture. Okay. CC. Here. Ashutosh has asked that what do you mean by CC? See here. CC stands for standard C compiler. And which comes in the outermost layer of this architecture. Why it comes at outermost layer? Because it is the application program. हम क्या करते हैं कि आप जब लैपटॉप परचेस करते हैं तो लैपटॉप में आपका हार्डवेयर रहता है तो हार्डवेयर इज देयर उसके ऊपर आप ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम डालते हैं विंडोज आपने डाला विंडोज में आपने जो इंटर विंडोज के जो इनबिल्ट सिस्टम कॉल है इनबिल्ट कमांड है वो आप एग्जीक्यूट करेंगे थर्ड लेयर में लेकिन अगर आपको सी प्रोग्राम एग्जीक्यूट करना है तो आपको सी कंपाइलर एडिशनली इंस्टॉल करना पड़ेगा So that is nothing but a outermost layer. Other application program comes at outermost layer of the architecture of the Unix. CC stand for C compiler. So आप क्या करेंगे कि आपके मशीन पे बाहर जैसे जाकर C program, C compiler install करेंगे. Java आप कहाँ पे install करते हैं? Later on we install the Java also. So Python, we install the Python. Then we install the .NET or like this many. Programming languages we are installed at other outermost layer. So that is the CC stand for C compiler. Like this, there can be a Python compiler, interpreter, Java compiler, or other application program that comes at outermost layer. Okay. So that is a CC. Ashutosh, your doubt is clear? Or you are having any other doubt in your mind? Okay, very good. So CC means here in this figure only C compiler is shown, but you can see other here it is written other application program मतलब आपने अगर Java install किया तो Java का compiler आएगा आपने अगर Python install किया तो Python का interpreter यहाँ पे आएगा आप जितने भी additional software application program आपके laptop पे आपके machine पे install करेंगे That comes at outermost layer of this architecture. Okay, that comes at outermost layer of this architecture. Okay, clear to everybody? Anything? Any questions in your mind? You can free to ask. So. Shall we proceed to next? No doubt. Okay. Shall we proceed to next article or next slide? Yes. Here. Now next is the user's perspective. User's perspective. What do you mean by user's perspective? What is the title? Why this name is given here? User's perspective. So user's perspective means now what are the high level features of Unix system? What are the high level features of Unix operating system that how the user is looking towards this Unix operating system that we are going to learn here that is user's perspective matlab as a user what I can perceive in this Unix operating system what are the high level features of this Unix operating system that we will be going to discuss under this article that is user's perspective now you can see as on the slide it is given the high level features of Unix operating systems are file system second one is the processing environment third one is the building block primitives okay so these things we are going to learn in this article means as a user you are related with file systems as a user you are related with processing environment as a user you are related with various building block primitives so that we are going to learn in this article, user's perspective. Okay. Three very important features, high level features of Unix operating systems. That is the file system, the processing environment, and the building block primitives are going to discuss under this article. Here, now the first one is the file system. What is the file system? So file system means every operating system, not only Unix. It is equally applicable to the Windows also and other operating systems. All these operating systems are having a file system. It is a very important features of any operating systems. Now you can see the Unix file system is characterized by hierarchical structure. Okay, kindly make a note. All these points are very important. The Unix file system is hierarchical. The Unix file system is characterized by consistent treatments of file data. The Unix file system is characterized by the ability to create and delete files. The Unix file system is characterized by dynamic growth of the files. The Unix file system is characterized by protection of the files data. And the Unix file system is characterized by the treatment of the peripheral devices as the file. Read it once again. I appeal to everybody that read the Unix file system characteristics. First one, it is characterized by hierarchical structure. So you can say that the Unix file system is hierarchical in nature. Secondly, you can say that the Unix file system giving the consistent treatments on file data. Consistent treatment on file data. Third one is it is ability to create the files and delete the files. So you can create the file, you can delete the files. And it is characterized by dynamic growth of the files. It is characterized by the protection of the files data. It is characterized by treatments of the peripheral devices as the file. Okay. Lastly, on this slide, it is written, the file system is organized as a tree with single root node called root, written as slash. Every non-leaf node of the file system structure is a directory of files, and files at the leaf node of the tree are either directory regular file or the special device file. So I appeal to everybody, kindly read this slide once again. So now in the next slide you can see how these all characteristics are here. This is the sample file system tree. Just now I said that the Unix file system is hierarchical in nature. Hierarchical in nature means it is like a tree structure. Hierarchical means it is like a tree structure. You can see everybody is everything is started with this tree root node. यहाँ पे जो टॉप मोस्ट में ये स्लैश दिखाई दे रहा है आपको, दैट इज कॉल्ड एज द रूट, रूट ऑफ द फाइल सिस्टम, रूट ऑफ द ट्री. ओके, दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सैंपल फाइल सिस्टम ट्री, दिस इज ऑल्सो दिस विल बी योर क्वेश्चन इन योर एग्जामिनेशन. एक्सप्लेन द फाइल सिस्टम स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ यूनिक्स. So here a slash is nothing but the, this is a file system, and slash is nothing but the root node. Slash is nothing but the root node. It is a root of the tree. Okay. Clear. You can read the file system is organized as a tree with the single root node. Every file system is having a single root node and was written as a slash. So slash means what? Slash means that is the root of that file system. Root of that file system. Every non-leaf node, Non-leaf node means what? Non-leaf. And what is the leaf? Leaf means the last node. Leaf ka matlab kya rehta hai? Leaf is the last node of the tree. And non-leaf node means intermediate node. So every intermediate node of the file system is called as directory of the files. Directory of the files. And the files at the leaf node are either directory, regular file, or special device file. Okay. Here. So here in this figure, you can see the root node is shown by the slash. And now the non-leaf node, is what? This is the leaf node. Okay. This MGP and this Mori, SH, date, who are all the leaf node. Pass WD are the leaf node. But SRC is not a leaf node. It is a non-leaf node. Date.c and who.c are the leaf node. So what is a non-leaf node? Non-leaf node are the directories. They are either directories, okay, of files. Okay, directories of files. They are the directories of files. Jaise ki yahan pe fs1. Fs1 is the directory. Ki jisme ye do file hai. Bin is the directory. Jisme teen file hai. Etc is the directory. Usme ek file hai. USR is the directory. Isme do file hai. Unix is the directory. Dev is the directory. Isme do file hai. So all these things, FS1, bin, etc, user, Unix, dev, all these things are the non-leaf node. So they are called as a directories. They are called as the directories of the file system. Aur jo leaf node hai, usse kya kahenge? The leaf node are either directories. Leaf node directory bhi reh sakti hai, leaf node regular file bhi ho sakti hai, ya leaf node special device file bhi ho sakti hai. So yahan pe I can show you the this pass WD is the directory. Okay, then SH, date, who are the files, and this TTY00, TTY01 are the special device files. Okay, special device files. So the leaf node may be the directories, leaf node may be the regular files, and leaf node may be the special device file. Clear to everybody? This is the sample file structure of the Unix file system. Okay, is this thing is clear to you? Hello. Yes, very good. Give reply. So if you are having any doubt, you can free to ask right now. So see, I can again repeat. This is the sample file system tree of the Unix file system. Everything is started with the slash. That is the root of the tree. The non-leaf node of the file system is the directories. Okay. And the leaf node may be directory, may be regular file, or may be special device file. Okay, so this is the sample tree of the Unix file system. Okay. Anybody is having any doubt, you can ask right now. Okay. You are free to ask. Here, what we will do, here we will stop now. I will take the attendance. You kindly give the attendance. I will call the roll number and the today date is 3rd February 2021. So give the attendance.
Roll number 98 is there. Roll number 98. Roll number 98. Roll number 180, 182, 182.
Present, sir.
Yes, very good. Roll number 90.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number 108.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number.
Hello, sir.
Yes, hello.
Roll number 98.
Yeah, 98. Oh, yes, very good. Roll number 83.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number 84.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number 95.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number 176. 176 is not. Roll number 139. Roll number 139. Roll number 117.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
139 present, sir.
139 present. Okay. Roll number 117. 117.
Present, sir.
121.
Present, sir.
Roll number 143. 143. Mute your audio. Mute your audio.
Present, sir.
96. Roll number 96. Roll number 96. Roll number 86. Roll number 145.
Present, sir.
Roll number 99.
Present, sir.
Roll number 112. 100.
Present.
Very good. Roll number 87.
Present, sir.
Roll number 147.
Present, sir.
Roll number roll number 181.
Present, sir.
Roll number 149.
Present, sir.
Very good. Roll number 105.
Present, sir.
Roll number 179.
Present, sir.
Roll number 100. Roll number 129. Roll number 102.
Present, sir.
Roll number 148.
Present, sir.
Roll number 133.
Present, sir.
Sir, 129 present.
129. Okay. Then roll number 123.
Present, sir.
85.
Present, sir.
93.
Present,
sir. 144 number.
146.
144, sir.
Just a minute. I will call the roll call. Don't speak in between. 146. Roll number 140.
Present.
180.
Present, sir.
137. 137. 163.
Present, sir.
115.
Present, sir.
104. 104.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. 118.
Present, sir.
135. 135. 153. Roll number 153. 177. 177.
Present, sir.
Very good. 119.
Present, sir.
116.
Present, sir.
132.
Present, sir.
114.
Present, sir.
Present, sir.
152.
Present, sir.
127. 127.
Present, sir.
131.
Present.
109.
Present.
130. 134.
Present, sir.
128.
Present, sir.
125.
Present. Present, sir.
Yes, yes. Now 140. 140. 103. 103.
Present, sir.
157. 178.
Yes, sir.
Present, sir.
Okay. 97.
Sir.
Yes, yes. Nikale. Nikale Akash.
Present, sir.
Yes. 97. 97 present. Yes. 140.
Present, sir.
Yes, yes. 141.
Present, sir.
150. Tejas Jadhav. 91. 142.
Present, sir.
154. 154. Roll number 89.
Present, sir.
Okay. Anybody remain? Anybody?
Sir, sir, roll number 101.
101.
Yes, sir.
144. Sir, roll.
Sir, roll number 94.
Roll number 124.
Mute your audio.
Sir, roll number 8.
Mute your audio. Mute your audio. Everybody, mute your audio. Mute your audio and listen carefully. Listen carefully. Those who have not given the attendance, their name are not called. I will share the link. You kindly write your roll number, name, and mark the attendance in today's lecture. Okay. I will share the Google link. Mark the attendance there. Now I will stop. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
संध्या पुस्तक टाकले वगैरे.